It's one great song after another, and one heavenly praise after another, on the Gospel Road from Family Life.
Sometimes the little boy in me wants to climb upon my father's knee. When the world outside gets too big for me, when the fear's too much for me to hide, and my fondest dreams have all but died, he always understands me when I say, hold me, hold me, I'm so afraid of the storm. That doesn't mean that I'm brave and bold, but oh, I want so much to serve you. So I'll follow if you'll lead the way, if I know you're not too far away. Just close enough to hear me when I say, the storm.
Morning. All right, we got some coffee in us. We're doing well. It's good to be here at Bethel Baptist Church this morning where God changes lives. Amen? Amen. A few announcements to get us started this morning. If you are new here and you haven't been here before, we'd like to, first of all, say welcome and thank you for joining us today and choosing to worship the Lord here at Bethel Baptist Church. I don't know what that was. A little spider or something. Here at Bethel Baptist Church, there is a gift for you if you're a first-time visitor. You can pick one of these two mugs. I like the travel mug. I think that's really cool. It's really nice and tall. Maybe it holds more candy than the other one, but it has candy in it, just so you're aware. So make sure you stop by the Welcome Center and pick up a mug for yourself. And then also, just so you're aware, starting today is the start of the Bethany Scholarship. What this is, and I believe we have brochures for camp available now as well. So if you're wondering what's there at the camp, it's a lot of fun things to do. My family has been vacationing there for several years, and we know quite a bit of the camp, and we've been there for practically a lifetime. But there's all kinds of fun things as far as like blobbing and swimming and archery and all kinds of stuff. We love to send kids to camp. It's a great opportunity for them to hear about Christ and to learn about Jesus through various chapel speakers that are going to be there throughout the summer. I remember as a kid just being impacted by that as well. So we're asking, and as a church, we're getting together to kind of help bring this scholarship program together for the kids. And what the kids can do is they can earn points towards this scholarship. And Janet Price is extremely knowledgeable about how this program works. So they can do all kinds of things like cleaning, taking sermon notes, and so on and so forth to earn these points towards the scholarship. And then we, as adults, need to be willing to kind of help that scholarship fund out a little bit and be helping the kids and be excited for them and be putting some monies towards that. Also, coming up is Ministers March Mania. Now, this is a little embarrassing. I've been asked to be on a basketball team. And if you know me, I think I can only dribble a ball with one hand now. So they've probably got the upper hand on me right now. But I'm supposed to be on the green team for this. And this is a fundraising event for Love, Inc. of Southern Chautauqua County, specifically. So this is a fundraising event for them. This is a ministry that we partner with that's in the area, and we help them out on a very regular basis. So we kind of wanted to help show our support and our love for them. They are also doing as well a bake sale. This is another way that you can help. So if you're wanting to help out in another way besides sponsoring your pastor on the basketball team, you can also cook up some brownies or some cookies and donate that for Love Inc. And they'll have an auction for the bake sale. So that's on April 20th, and that starts at 1 p.m. at the Faulkner High School. Also, just so that you're aware, this has been an ongoing thing. There is a Facebook page for the church. It looks like that. No. Okay. That. Sorry. There is a Facebook page for the church. If you like and subscribe or, you know, say that you're a fan of the Facebook page, that helps drive traffic. Also, we're trying to be a little more active with it. So this has been a thing for a while, but the request that we're making from you as a congregation is if you see a post from the Facebook page, please take a moment and share that post on Facebook. It kind of helps drive some more traffic and kind of use it as a virtual front door for the church to let people know that we're here. And it's kind of, in a sense, free advertising for us to let people know that we're here, we love God, we love Christ, we love our neighbors, and we're here where this is a place where God changes lives. Also, last announcement, I'd like to say thank you to all of those who helped with the pancake breakfast last Sunday for Resurrection Sunday. It was really appreciated. There was a lot of people that helped out with, you know, setting up to serving and being in the kitchen, working out over a hot stove or oven, to tearing down and cleaning the floor. The whole thing is a process. It's quite the project in order to accomplish that. And there was a lot of people who did some of it, and there were some people who did all of it. And I just want to say, from me to you, thank you for participating and helping in that. It was really, I really enjoyed the breakfast, and I appreciate your efforts in helping with that. Turn now in your Bible, as we conclude announcements, turn in your Bible to Psalm 130. I'll read through the passage and then respond in prayer. Psalm 130 says, a song of ascents. Out of the depths I have cried to you, O Lord. Lord, hear my voice. Let your ears be attentive to the voice of my supplications. If you, Lord, should mark iniquities, O Lord, who could stand? But there is forgiveness with you, that you may be feared. I wait for the Lord, my soul does wait, and in his word I do hope. My soul waits for the Lord. More than the watchman for the morning, indeed, more than the watchman for the morning, O Israel, hope in the Lord. For with the Lord there is loving kindness, and with him is abundant redemption, and he will redeem Israel from all his iniquities. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we reflect upon this passage and we meditate and ask and that you would hear our prayer, that you would hear our cries. Lord, we ask that you would help us to understand the fact that you are a God who forgives. Lord, if it were not for the work of Christ, who would be able to stand before you? Who would be able to ascend the mountain of the Lord? Who would be able to come into your presence? For Lord, we know that without Christ, we are individuals who curse and scorn your name, that we are individuals who see ourselves as wise in our own eyes, and that we rebel against your word. But because of the fact that you are a forgiving God, that you are a God that is abundant in your loving kindness towards us, towards your people, because of the work of Christ at the cross, Lord, we know that we can come before you now in your presence, but not because of who we once were, but because of Christ's work and the fact that he has now made us wholly and perfectly just and holy, that he has made us to be blameless as we stand before you. Lord, we thank you for the fact that you have accomplished this work, and we know and we look forward to the day when you will redeem your people and you will save us from all of our iniquities. And we thank you, Lord, for your abundant loving kindness, your covenant faithfulness that you have for us. Lord, we pray these things in your name. Amen.
Ephesians chapter 2, verse 4 and 5 tell us, but because of his great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive in Christ, even when we were dead in transgressions. It is by grace you have been saved. And it just, that verse alone makes me think of the first verse that we'll be singing at Calvary. Please stand with us as we sing.
years I spent in vanity and pride.
That's something that makes me joyful. I trust it's something that makes you joyful as well. Some people think of it as a Christmas song, but there's not much about Christmas in there. I'm not sure why some people think that, but you know, I'll use it as an excuse to sing at any time of the year. We think about how great our Lord is, and I'd like to read Psalm 145, Great is the Lord and most worthy of praise. His greatness no one can fathom.
You give life, you are love.
And at this time, the children can be dismissed for children's church.
I absolutely love the bridge of that song. You will make these bones live. It's from Ezekiel 34, talking about the valley of dry bones. And just, you see God in his resurrection power. Even though Israel is there, they're not listening to the word, but the word is powerful, even to the dead. The dead listen to the word of the Lord. Amen. Well, turn in your Bible to Ephesians chapter 1. Ephesians chapter 1, we're going to continue and pick up kind of where we left off with the spiritual blessings portion. I'm going to, again, kind of in similar fashion as previous weeks, read from verse 3 all the way down to 14. And today we're going to just cover in the sermon itself just verses 13 to 14. But we're going to read from Ephesians chapter 1, verse 3 all the way down to 14. this kind of helps kind of bring some context back into it. It says, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places in Christ. Just as he chose us in him before the foundation of the world, that we would be holy and blameless before him in love, he predestined us to adoption as sons through Jesus Christ to himself, according to the kind intention of his will, to the praise of the glory of his grace, which he freely bestowed on us in the beloved. In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses, according to the riches of his grace, which he lavished on us in all wisdom and insight. He made known to us the mystery of his will, according to his kind intention, which he purposed in him, with a view towards an administration suitable to the fullness of times, that is, the summing up of all things in Christ, things in the heavens and things on the earth. In him also we have obtained an inheritance, having been predestined according to his purpose, who works all things after the counsel of his will, to the end that we who were the first to hope in Christ would be to the praise of his glory. In him you also, after listening to the message of truth, the gospel of your salvation, having also believed, you were sealed in him with the Holy Spirit of promise, who is given as a pledge of our inheritance, with a view to the redemption of God's own possession, to the praise of his glory." Let's pray. Heavenly Father, I come before you and I humbly ask that you would guide my words and my lips this morning, that your word would prevail over my own opinions, that we would hear your truth, and that it would take effect in our hearts this morning. I pray that there would be conviction, especially of sin, if there be sin in our lives, that we would be hearing the Spirit's provoking in our hearts, that these are things that we need to be working on and understanding, and that we need to be taking those things off and putting on the new man as Christ. Lord, I pray that we would hear your words and that we would be rest assured of the truth that we find this morning, of the gospel and of the work that's done here. Lord, we pray these things in your name. Amen. So kind of to catch us up a little bit, because we took a couple weeks off of Ephesians, a little bit of a break for Palm Sunday and Easter. So to help us remind ourselves of what's going on in verses 3 through 14, there is a structure that kind of bridges all of these verses together, which is that Paul is praising God for the spiritual blessings that we receive in salvation. He's praising God for the harmonious work that's being done from each person of the Trinity. And we kind of see this as we work through this paragraph. Actually, it's all one sentence. But as we work through this paragraph, we see that there is the predetermined plan of the Father. There is the redemption that's done by the Son. There is the inheritance that is given to us through the Son. And today we're going to be talking about specifically the sealing that is done by the Holy Spirit. The seal of that is in the Holy Spirit itself. This is the third person of the Trinity. And they're all working together perfectly, harmoniously, just as was predetermined and planned, and that they are all in cooperation with each other. And I say this because this is important to understand, that there is not one person which the Father has planned whom Jesus Christ would lose. Right? As John talks about in his gospel, Jesus is telling them that he is the great shepherd, that all that have come to him or have been planned by the Father himself, that he should lose nobody until the end of days, that even into eternity, they will all be of his flock. He knows his sheep. They call him by name. They hear his voice and they follow him. So there is this perfect working together of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit in redemption. As we look at this passage, verses 13 and 14 specifically, it kind of helps answer this question for us. Can a believer lose his or her salvation? Can a person lose his salvation? I'm going to submit today and argue from Scripture that no, a person cannot lose his salvation. That when a person becomes a believer, he receives eternal life, meaning life that does not end. And no work of man is going to upset the plans of God. It was God that planned it from the beginning. It was God that brought about salvation through the work of the cross. It was Christ that gave us an inheritance. It was God that seals us with the Holy Spirit. It's going to be God that works in us and affects in us. It's not going to be man that ruins it for God's plan. Salvation has never been about us in the first place. It's all been about God's glory in the first place. It's all been a work of God. It's all been His doing. Nothing in here, in these 14 verses, do we see anything about man contributing anything towards salvation. Therefore, an argument can be made that no matter what man does, it cannot, cannot frustrate the plans of God. It cannot frustrate God's work in your life. As we jump into this passage, we see verse 13, it says, having heard, having heard. In other words, these individuals there in Ephesus have probably heard this message of truth of salvation at some point in time. It must have been that Paul had come to them during his missionary journey and had preached to them. So specifically, Paul talks about this message of salvation that he, or the content of his preaching, that it is, I'm sorry, wrong verse. Verse 13 says, in him you also, after listening to what? The message of truth. After hearing the message of truth. Kind of talked about this last week where the resurrection itself was not done in a corner. It was not somewhere where no one had ever seen it or heard of it before. It was displayed before all men. This account, this message is truth. It's not a fabled story. There was a reason why the apostles were willing to go to the grave. There is a reason why the apostles were willing to die for the message of the gospel. Thank you. They believed it to be truth. They truly believed that Jesus Christ had physically resurrected from the grave. Not like kinda resurrected, not like zombie resurrected. He was not like metaphorically resurrected. He was not resurrected in the hearts only of the disciples. No, he was actually physically resurrected from the grave. This is a message of truth. And this message of truth is for those who hear it, the gospel of your salvation. That word gospel literally means good news. I've harped on this so many times in my previous church with children's ministries. Every time that I came across this word, what is the gospel? What is the gospel, guys? And it was, yeah, thank you. It was required for them to reply every time. Good news. What is the gospel?
Good news.
Thank you. It is good news. I will catechize this until the day I die. It is good news. Good news because it means that we receive salvation. It is good news because it means that through Christ's work that we can be saved from the condemnation to come. It is good news because it means that we are no longer at enmity with God. It is good news because now we can have fellowship with God. It is more than just simply that we used to be his enemy and now we're in a neutral state. As we talked about in weeks prior leading up to this, God has taken us and he's brought us from afar and he's made us to be his sons. He's put his name on us. He's included us in his family and he's even promised us an inheritance that is eternal life. We are his children. Good news. It is good news for sure. And it is specifically your salvation, your escape from condemnation. Now, it does say specifically Paul saying that they have heard this message. And it's very important to kind of emphasize this part because it is by means of preaching the gospel by which people hear the message. Right? In Romans chapter 10, Paul states that how then will they call on him in whom they have not believed? When will they believe in him whom they have not heard? How will they hear without a preacher? This is why it's so desperately important to be sending missionaries to far off places. Why it's so desperately important for us to be speaking this to our friends in everyday places. So that they may hear the gospel that's being spoken. That they might hear the message. And it even says, how beautiful are the feet of those who bring good news of good things. Romans 10:17 says, so faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of Christ. They heard this message, but it's even more than that. In Ephesians 1:13, it says, after they heard it, they also believed. That is, so it's not good enough to just simply hear it, but you have to take it to heart. You have to take this truth and you have to take, in a sense, ownership of this truth for yourself. And you have to believe that, yes, Jesus is the Christ. Jesus is the promised Messiah. Yes, through him, I receive salvation. And by there is no other name under heaven by which man may be saved. It is only through Christ and him alone. And you have to take that by faith. Notice also that there's a lack of anything else that's required. It doesn't say that they believed and were circumcised. It doesn't say that they believed and then did certain rites. It doesn't even say that they believed and were baptized. Baptism is not a requirement for salvation. Nothing of an action by any means is required for salvation. It is by faith and by faith alone by which we are saved. But it is faith in the message of the good news of our salvation, of the message of truth of Jesus and his Son. Now these two, they are technically speaking in grammar, bear with me, these are participles. I know you probably thought you were done with grammar when you left school. I apologize. But these are participles, meaning that these two words, having believed and having heard, are not necessarily the main idea, but they're supporting the main idea, and that they're kind of working as temporal indicators or kind of logical preconditions that are necessary for this main idea. The main idea in this is that you are sealed by the Spirit. You are sealed in the Spirit itself. This is Paul's main idea through these two verses is that you are sealed by the Holy Spirit. And those two things are logically, I'll say it like this, logically necessary in order for you to receive the Holy, receive the sealing of the Holy Spirit itself. Now, over in Romans, Paul makes this very clear. If you are a believer, all who believe have received the Spirit. Romans chapter 8, there's a clear line of God's choosing, Christ's working, people who believe, his calling, his work, his sealing, all working all the way through the day of redemption when we will see Christ in full, where we will be glorified and living in his presence. There is a clear line where all who have been planned for salvation, all who have been called, all who have been all who believe will all receive eternal life. As I mentioned earlier in John chapter 10, Jesus makes it clear, I will lose none. I will lose nobody. Not even the enemy himself will be able to snatch him out of my hand. So we are all sealed. Now, this is kind of an interesting picture that Paul is using here, talking about a sealing of the Holy Spirit or by the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is the agent that's doing this work. Now, we don't really necessarily use a seal nowadays. Now, this, and it can be used in kind of as an illustration for what Paul is trying to explain and illustrate the work of the Holy Spirit here. Now, a lot of times in ancient days, during the time of Paul is writing, a seal is usually used by kind of melting wax on specifically like a letter or perhaps some sort of important documentation. Like when I bought my house, I received a deed for my house, or it got marked and it's added to the record. The transaction of my purchase of my home was added to the record and it's official. That seal in ancient days was helped to show that it was official. There was a certain insignia that was on the seal to let you know who the author was, and that because it's from a certain author, that letter itself had authority and that it's official. And if the seal is still there, if it's unbroken, you know that that document itself has not been tampered with since the author placed his mark in the seal. That was the way by which they were able to make accurate and official documentation for all kinds of transactions. You can also kind of say that this seal was a mark of identification of ownership. When a person wrote it and placed his signet in the seal itself, it lets you know who the author was. And this is probably more so kind of what Paul is talking about here, is that God himself has placed his mark upon you to let the world know that you are his. You are now one of the children of God. It should be clear in your life, after having believed, that there is, that the Spirit is doing a work in your life, and other people will look at you and say, there is something that is different about that person. Because faith makes a person different. Faith, obedience follows faith, and they realize, and the person realizes that they follow through the words of Christ and obedience to him because they love him. There is now a mark of identification on you in your life from now until the end of days. You now belong to Christ. Very much kind of like what farmers would do on the ranch if the cattle were roaming free, to make sure that everyone know that that cow, particular cow, belongs to him. He would take a brand, make it hot, press it into the cow, and now that cow has the mark of ownership of belonging to a specific farmer from that time until he be brought home. Everyone knows who that cow belongs to. I'm not saying you're a cow. I'm saying simply that everyone knows that you belong to God. This is kind of, and this seal is probably marking the us individually to save us, to say that we are receiving salvation. Specifically, if we look, for example, at Revelation chapter 7, verse 3, it says, "Do not harm the earth or the sea or the trees until we have sealed the bondservants of our God on their foreheads." This is specifically a mark of identification to let people, to make sure that everyone knows that these individuals are set apart so that they would not receive condemnation, but they're instead going to be receiving eternal life, the inheritance. Again, this is something that is done by the Holy Spirit himself. Paul makes this clear that this is a work of God that is done specifically through that third person that is the Holy Spirit. He's the one that's making this seal in our lives. And we could talk about other works of the Holy Spirit that he does in our life as well. Talking about the regeneration of the hearts, the fact that he sanctifies us in our daily walk. Now here specifically stating that he marks us with his seal to show that we belong to God. Paul is also making another illustration to show that we belong to God and the importance of Christ's work and the Holy Spirit's work in this seal. It's described here in the New American Standard Translation as a pledge. This is a pledge. There's some illustration that's kind of needed to help illustrate what a pledge means in this scenario. Because this word, another way to put it, is a down payment. It is, as a matter of fact, a lot of times it was used in contractual agreements during Paul's day. Kind of like if you wanted someone, a contractor or a builder, to come out to your house and say, build a wall inside your house for you, and you come up with a price and you agree on a price, and then the owner gives a down payment, a pledge of money that says, go ahead, I agree, do the work. But he doesn't give the whole sum of the money to the contractor, to the builder. He only gives a portion of the money to the builder. And he then when the builder comes and finishes the work, then he gives the rest of the money to the builder. And he's talking about that down payment as that pledge. It's a promise that more will come. Do you understand? Do you see the illustration that's being used? The Holy Spirit's mark on us is a promise that more is to come. This is why Paul is praising God, talking about the spiritual blessings that we are receiving in our salvation, that there is more to come for us. This is only just a down payment, right? When we go to Olive Garden for food, right? We don't go to Olive Garden for the soup or the salad and the breadsticks for dinner, you know? We might do that maybe for lunch, but for dinner, right? We go to Olive Garden because of the lasagna or the filet mignon, right? Or maybe the salmon. That's why we go to Olive Garden, because we want the best food that's there. The soup, the salad, the breadsticks, that's a down payment to show me that something better is coming, right? It's like a promissory note. It's something else is better is coming. I know that there's a cook in the kitchen back there who's got my filet mignon on the grill getting nice and hot for me over easy or medium well. Over easy, that's for eggs. I know that there's a cook in the kitchen who's getting my food ready. And that the food that I have now before me, that chicken and gnocchi soup, yeah, it's pretty good. It's pretty tasty, but that's not why I showed up. I showed up for the filet mignon. I showed up for the really good stuff. It's a down payment. The best is still coming. It's a contractual agreement. The other thing about this, it is a seal that is until the redemption, to the redemption. She says there in Ephesians chapter 1, verse 14, that this is given as a pledge of our inheritance with a view towards the redemption. Now, this redemption was used earlier in verse 7, talking about the purchase price that was necessary for us to receive salvation with Christ's work on the cross. But redemption here in this verse is being used in a different sense than it was in verse 7. Redemption here is being used with a sense of a future hope, a future release. The idea of being set free from the current groanings. It's kind of best way to illustrate it is Romans chapter 8, verse 23. It says, and not only this, but we also ourselves, having the first fruits of the Spirit, even we ourselves groan within ourselves because of our sufferings. We groan within ourselves, waiting eagerly for our adoption as sons, the redemption of our body. The day when this old body becomes new again and God makes all things new, that's the day of redemption that is being spoken of in Ephesians. That's the day of redemption that we are being sealed towards. So in other words, that argument and that question that was brought to us before, and can a person lose his salvation? The answer is no, because the sealing mark on us done by the Holy Spirit on a believer is good from the day he believes until the day in which he is redeemed in glory. And no plan of man will ever change that. Nothing can separate us from the love of God. Lastly, one of the intentions for why this is done is for the praise of His glory, to the praise of His glory. The comfort for us is the fact that God guarantees that we will get to come home. And this should result in praise for us. This should result from our lips glory unto God. It is because He is showing and demonstrating His love towards us. Right? He doesn't have to do this. He knows we're going to screw up. He knows that we're going to take a few missteps every now and then. He knows we're not perfect. But praise God for the work that the Holy Spirit has done here, where He's placed His seal upon us to make sure that we get to come home. This is very much the same idea that's repeated in 2 Corinthians 5:5. It's almost parallel. It says, now He who prepared us for this very purpose is God, who gave to us the Spirit as a pledge. And then 1 Peter 1:5, we are who are protected by the power, protected by the power of God, not by the vain works of man, not by our striving, but by the power of God through faith for salvation to be revealed. When? At the last time. This work of the Holy Spirit is a work that will be done through and through from the start of our faith to the very end of days. And nothing will change that. We can rest assured in this promise that God will bring us home. Amen. What is the gospel? Good news. I call that good news. I'm going to transition now over and pray as the deacons come forward for communion. Heavenly Father, we thank You for the fact that You give us this good news. I thank You for the fact that You have accomplished all of this for us. We thank You especially for the seal in the Holy Spirit that you have given to us. The very fact that nothing can change your plans, that nothing can undo your work of salvation. No matter how far we sin, no matter how seems like far we want to stray away from you, Lord, you call us home, we call us unto yourself, not just for to be a part of your family, but to walk closely with you and to have a relationship with you so that we might be in your presence, so that we might be able to be before you holy and blameless. Lord, as we transition now into communion, I ask that you would quiet our minds and our hearts, that we would examine our hearts as we look to these things. Lord, I pray that you would remind us that your work is a finished work, that it accomplished everything that it intended to. How can we say that your work was sufficient if we think that it can make us a believer, but then we can then overturn your good work through our own failures? We were failures before we met you, Lord. Lord, we praise you and we thank you for these good things. We pray this in your name. Amen. As I mentioned in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 27 and 29, Paul makes a warning unto us about taking this bread and this cup, that we do not do it lightly. This is something that we must do with sincerity of heart and understanding what it represents. This cup, I would also warn us that it is for believers only. I invite whoever claims to be a believer, but if you are not a believer this morning, then I would ask that you just simply allow the bread and the cup to just pass. This is something that we use to practice and signify the finished work of Christ, that we have a union with Christ himself. Now, in the night in which he was betrayed, he came through and he did this with Last Supper with his disciples. Ask that now that we would examine ourselves as we are about to distribute this bread, and I ask now that, Brian, that you would pray for us as we examine ourselves and pass this cup. I'm sorry, the bread.
Dear Lord, we ask that you bring to mind something that we have, something that we need to confess. I thank you that we don't have to be perfect. I thank you that you broke your body for me, for all of us. Thank you for that gift. Amen.
Amen. says in 1 Corinthians 11, "For I received from the Lord that which I delivered also to you, that the Lord Jesus, in the night that he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.'" Larry, would you please pray for us over the cup?
Sure. Heavenly Father, thank you for being willing to give up your son, for allowing him to take our punishment. Father, your word tells us that not only did Jesus take our sin upon him, but he became sin for us. Jesus, thank you so much. Father, help us walk in a manner that's worthy of what you've done for us. Please forgive us of our sins. Help us go forward knowing that we are sealed with your Spirit, that we are your children, and that we can walk in the strength of the Holy Spirit. Help us to do that this week. In Jesus' name, we pray. Amen.
In the same way, he took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Just make a quick reminder. Usually at this time, there is a benevolence fund that is given by the church unto those who may be in need. That is available if you would like to. You can make a donation to that in the basket in the lobby as well. It was just a simple reminder there. I ask now that we all stand together. We're going to sing the doxology. Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures hear below. Praise Him, all ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen. In Philippians chapter 1, verse 6, he's writing to the church, Paul is, and he says, "For I am confident of this very thing, that he who began a good work in you will perfect it until the day of Jesus Christ." May that be a promise and a blessing for you this morning, this work of the Holy Spirit, that he will carry us home and he will perfect in us his work. Pray this. Thank you. You are dismissed.
To the Gospel Road from listener-funded Family Life at familylife.org.
It's the last mile you must trod, and I